Good morning again for those joining us early this morning. We're going to get started in just about one more minute. All right, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Invasive Mussel Collaborative Webinar, Lessons Learned from Recent Open Water Applications and Field Trials of Zequanox. My name is Erica Jensen. I'm a project manager with the Great Lakes Commission. The Great Lakes Commission is providing backbone support to the Invasive Mussel Collaborative, which is an initiative working to advance scientifically sound technology for invasive mussel control to produce measurable ecological and economic benefits. The collaborative is intended to provide a framework for communication and coordination, identifying the needs and objectives of resource managers, prioritizing supporting science, developing communication strategies, and ultimately aligning science and management goals into a common agenda. If you'd like to know more about the Invasive Mussel Collaborative, we encourage you to visit our website if you have not done so already. Our website is www.invasivemusselcollaborative.net. Our website currently includes background information on the collaborative, including a recording of an informational webinar we held in December of last year. We hope to be making significant updates to our website in the coming months, and we encourage you to check back periodically for those updates and for more information. Today's webinar is the first in a series of webinars that will be hosted by the Invasive Mussel Collaborative. We will be recording the webinar and archiving it on the Invasive Mussel Collaborative website. As many of you are aware, it's widely recognized that invasive zebra and quagga mussels are causing significant ecological and economic impacts across North America. Recent advances in biocontrol technology represent an exciting potential technique to manage invasive mussels. However, knowledge and understanding of how to apply these techniques, their results and effectiveness is still limited. This morning, we are pleased to have representatives from the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality, the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources, and the U.S. Geological Survey to present and share their experiences on use of Zequanox, including methods and results, and answer questions about their efforts. In just a few minutes, we'll begin our first presentation, but before we begin, I have a few logistical items to cover. As I mentioned, today's webinar will be recorded and posted on the Invasive Mussel Collaborative website. We expect to have the recording posted within the next few days. We are also pleased to have more than 150 people registered for this webinar. And due to the large number of people participating, all attendees' lines, phone lines, audio lines are on mute. Attendees will remain muted throughout the webinar. And we will be taking questions, but we will only be taking questions in written format. Thus, if you have a question for any of our presenters, you may type it into the questions box of your GoToWebinar dashboard. You may submit questions at any time during the webinar. We may be able to answer one or two questions following each presentation. However, we will hold the majority of questions to be addressed following all three presentations. We will do our best to take all of your questions or comments during the webinar. If you have to leave the webinar before we are able to get to your question, you are strongly encouraged to go back and review the recording once it is posted, as we hope to be addressing your question later on in the webinar. If you experience any technical difficulties this morning, you may send a chat to my colleague, Sarah Cook, using the chat function of the GoToWebinar, and she will do her best to help you. So with those logistical remarks, I'm pleased to introduce our first presenter this morning, Jim Loma. Jim is a fisheries biologist with the U.S. Geological Survey Upper Midwest Environmental Sciences Center. He started his career as a physical science technician at the center in 1990, and he accepted a few multi-year training opportunities as a hatchery biologist and an assistant hatchery manager at two Fish and Wildlife Service fish hatcheries before beginning his current position in 2010. Jim's research efforts have focused on dreissenid mussel control, including the evaluation of Zequanox for use in open water environments. And Jim will be presenting on some of those research efforts this morning. So Jim, if you are ready, I'm going to hand off presenter status to you.
Yep, I'm ready. So thank you. This morning I'm going to talk to you a little bit.
We can see your screen, Jim.
You see that? How do I get rid of this guy here? Just close that. Nope. Can you see this panel here, I'm assuming?
Oh, nope, we only see your slide.
Oh, okay, good. Then I'll continue on. Sorry about that. So I'll talk to you a little bit today about our work over the past few years about the application of Zequanox and also the assessment of it. There we go. So first off, I'd like to acknowledge the many partners that we've had over the several years that we've been working on Zequanox. They were integral to getting our work done. Important to note their involvement, especially some private organizations like the Tonka Bay Marina that allowed us to stage equipment on their site and also expended resources and time and moving our equipment around, and also some private landowners. So special thanks to those groups. A little bit of the outline about what I'm going to talk about today. I'll touch on some of our earlier work, non-targetal animal studies, a variety of different studies from laboratory, mesocosm, and also a mobile lab study. And I'll move into some of our efficacy and application studies that were done in the field using our mobile lab and also field enclosures. A couple of ongoing studies that we have going on with Zequanox. And then lastly, I'll touch on some data needs that we have identified for Zequanox and also for other control tools. So jumping into the non-target animal studies, these studies, again, were conducted to assess the exposure related effects of Zequanox on species of mussels, fish, and invertebrates that had the potential to be exposed in open water applications. Again, we used a variety of different systems to do these studies in laboratory and in outdoor mesocosm, and also one study in a mobile lab. Yeah. The lab studies, we did three different studies in a laboratory to assess seven species of native mussels, the Glochidia and newly transformed juvenile mussels. And also one study that looked at the exposure-related effects to nine species of freshwater fish, young of the year animals. These treatments all exceeded the open water label of Zequanox. The open water label is for 8 hours of exposure duration to up to 100 milligrams per liter of active ingredient. These treatments are all 24 hours in duration. with concentrations ranging from 50 to 300 milligrams per liter as active ingredient. They were static exposures with the exception of fish. The fish were exposed to a 24-hour continuous dose of this material in a flow-through apparatus, which is shown in the second photograph from the right. The juvenile mussels were, that was a static, semi-static system. It was static during the exposures. The chambers are shown in the lower right photograph. For assessment that we did, the glaucidia were assessed at 6, 12, and 24 hours throughout the exposure, the viability. The mussels were then maintained in those chambers for 7 days and then assessed for survival after that time. The fish were exposed in that flow-through system, then moved into a holding system for 22 days when they're assessed for survival and also for body condition. So just to highlight some of the results from those studies, the glaucidia, we saw reduced viability in two of the six species that were assessed at 6 hours at 50 milligrams per liter and in four of the six species at 100 milligrams per liter. We did notice that our treatment that used a heat deactivated product, which destroys the toxins that induce persistent muscle mortality, was caused more of an impact than the heat deactivated product, which indicates that it's likely due to the addition of the product, not necessarily to the toxins that was causing the impact of the glaucidia. The juvenile mussels, we saw survival in five of the seven species that were exposed up to the 100 milligrams per liter for 24 hours was comparable to the controls. The two species that were not, the black sandshell mussels, had pretty poor control survival, so it's hard to draw conclusions on that species. The plain pocketbook, however, did have reduced survival in 100 milligram per liter treatment group. Their survival is about 18.8% in that group. The fish in the 24-hour continuous dose exposure had a wide variation in response. The LC50 values ranged from a low of 8.9 milligrams per liter for lake sturgeon, 177 approximately for walleye, and we couldn't even calculate a LC50 value for bluegill because we did not have mortality that exceeded 20% in any of the treatment groups. As you can see on the bottom of the screen, there's some notes for or references, citations for publications that are on this work. That'll all be published on the collaborative website, so you don't need to write that down. Moving into the outdoor mesocosm studies that we did with our non-target animals, we did three different tests in our outdoor system. These were 1,000-liter tanks that were supplied with well water. These exposures were consistent with the open water label and the fact that they were an 8-hour exposure duration and concentrations from 0, 50, and 100 milligrams per liter. The three studies included one study that looked at two species of aquatic invertebrates, adult amphipods, scuds, and some burrowing mayfly nymphs. One study that we exposed spawning fathead minnow adults to Zequanox and allowed them to spawn then after that. And then we also exposed the newly deposited eggs to Zequanox. The assessments that we did on those, the invertebrates were assessed 72 hours after exposure for survival. The fatty minerals, we used a variety of different assessments, including survival of adults that were exposed, the egg deposition from the adults, the egg hatchability, and also the reproductive success of the F1 generation. Before I move into results on that, I'll touch on the mobile lab study that we did. In that study, we exposed seven species of subadult and adult animals, native mussels, to the Zequanox in 350-liter replicated tanks that were supplied with river water. There were static exposures of 8 and 24 hours of duration. 0, 50, and 100 milligrams per liter. Those animals after exposure were maintained in cages within the river for 30 days before being assessed for survival. We also took samples for histological examination to see if there's any sublethal effects. To touch on the results of those various studies now, in the mesocosm trials, we didn't see any significant effect on the survival of invertebrates. We also saw no effect on mortality to the fatted male adults and no impact to the egg deposition or hatchability. And all of the F1 generations from those two fatted minnow trials have now spawned this summer. The mobile lab study where we exposed the native mussels, subadults and adults, the 30-day survival on those animals all exceeded 95% regardless of the exposure duration or the treatment concentration. And histopathology did not observe any differences between the mussels in the high treatment concentrations and the control groups. Moving into the field studies, these studies, we did a variety of different studies to assess the efficacy of Zequanox for controlling Dracinid mussels and also to evaluate the potential use of subsurface application to reduce the amount of Zequanox required during treatments. We used three different test systems to do these studies, the first being our mobile lab study where we have these 350-liter tanks as shown in upper left photograph there. Then we had a study where we, a couple of different studies where we used 2.25 square meter in-lake enclosures, that's in the bottom right photograph. And then last summer we did a study in Lake Minnetonka where we moved up to some 27 square meter enclosures that were in the lake. Those enclosures were all in about 4.5 to 5 feet of water. We did a couple of different application techniques, a whole water application where we applied the material in a stock solution and mixed it throughout the entire water column, and also subsurface applications where we injected a Zequanox concentrated stock into the water column to try and create a stratified treatment layer in the lower portion of the water column. The concentrations in these studies were analyzed and, by spectroscopy and compared to a standard curve. the assessments that we did in these studies utilized a variety of techniques, including zebra mussel survival. We allowed zebra mussels to adhere to the substrates shown in the upper two photographs. Those substrate pans were placed in the mesh bags and placed in the treated areas. After the treatment, they were maintained in the lakes for 30 days before being assessed for survival. The study, one of the studies that we did in the 2.25 square meter enclosures, we looked at the efficacy of Zequanox treatment for removing adhering Dracinid mussels. So we looked at on native mussels. So we looked at the colonization pre and post treatment on those mussels shown in the middle two photographs. We also looked at in those smaller in-lake enclosures the density of zebra mussels adhering to rocks in the treated areas pre and post treatment. And in the study that we did last summer in the larger in-lake enclosures, in addition to the survival on the substrates, we also placed these multi-plate samplers shown in the bottom left to assess colonization pre and post treatment in the treated areas. So the results that we saw in those field trials, in the lab study, in the mobile lab study, in the tanks, we saw zebra mussel ranging, mortality ranging from 82 to 99% in the treated groups, regardless of the treatment concentration or exposure duration. We did three exposure durations from 6, 9, and 12 hours. And we were able to maintain subsurface concentrations near the target concentrations in those trials, which led on to some of the open water enclosure trials. In those trials where we did the in-lake enclosure trials, in the trial that we looked at the use of Zequanox to control adhering zebra mussels on native mussels, we reduced descent adherence from 53 to 68% in those trials, depending on the concentration. And the union of survival between the control and the treated groups did not differ. Lumping some of those studies together, the zebra mussel survival on those, or mortality in the that were on those substrate trays ranged from 41 to 74% in the whole water treatments, and from 28 to 64% in the subsurface application. And again, that's multiple trials and both treatment concentrations. The zebra mussel density on the rocks in the two quarter square meter enclosures was reduced 75% in the whole water column treatments and 58% in the subsurface application treatments. The biomass on the multiplate samplers that we did last summer is still pending, so we don't have results to show you at that time for this. The concentrations that we observed in the trial last summer are shown on the graph on the right, and they were more variable and lower in the subsurface applications, which isn't terribly, I guess it's expected, let's put that way. More information can be found on OAS as well in some open file reports that's published. Again, this will be available on the website for your access. The ongoing studies that we have now with Zequanox at UMass include an early life stage fatted minnow fry exposure to complete that life cycle of those animals. That study was initiated on June 24th of this year with less than 48-hour-old fry. They were exposed in 100-liter tanks in our outdoor mesocosms, and then after treatment, those animals were placed into the 1,000-liter tanks. They'll be maintained for 90 days before we assess them for survival and growth at that time. Due to the findings of impact on the lake sturgeon in our initial studies, we decided to do a exposure that was more consistent with the open water label. So we initiated that study on the 15th of July, where we exposed some fingerlings in our indoor fish tanks to concentrations of 0.50 to 100 milligrams per liter for an 8-hour exposure duration. We're going to hold those animals for 30 days and then assess them for survival, growth, and body condition at that time. To date, we have not observed any mortality in those animals. Some of the data needs that we have identified for Zequanox and for other control tools include determining impacts to other critical non-target animals that may be in a desired treatment area. Determining the treatment-related impacts on nutrient cycling and how that may, how a treatment may impact nutrient movement throughout a system. Related to that, determining how a mass descended mussel mortality may impact the water quality in the treated water body. Also, developing treatment application techniques for dynamic environments. We saw variable results in our concentrations when we were treating in those larger enclosures. So treating in dynamic environments is somewhat challenging. So developing application techniques and potentially alternative formulations of products to treat larger scale energy-rich environments would be desirable. Determining how often we need to treat to control animals to an acceptable level of control, and then also determining what that acceptable level of descended control is. And lastly, if we can develop some sort of standardized protocol for evaluating these control tools. So if I have any time, I'll take a couple questions. Otherwise, we can try and answer some later after the other presentations.
Jim, I think we're going to take one question just quickly since we have a minute here.
Okay, the question is, what histopathological tests were performed on non-target organisms? Were glycogen / FA analysis performed on the survivors or the mortalities?
Could you repeat that again? I didn't catch the first part of it.
Sure. What histopathological tests were performed on non-target organisms? Were glycogen / FA analyses performed, in parentheses, on the survivors or the mortalities?
Glycogen was not performed. The histopathology was done by the New York State Museum, and I think they just looked at the gross pathology of the gills and the digestive glands tissues.
All right, thank you, Jim.
We're going to do some work as well with some of the animals, the invertebrates that we collected and preserved during our trials last summer.
Great, thank you. Our next presenter this morning is Sarah Lesage. Sarah is an aquatic biologist specialist with the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality and is the Aquatic Invasive Species Program Coordinator for the state of Michigan. Sarah has served in this capacity since 2010, and she organizes statewide interdepartmental efforts to prevent, detect, and control aquatic invasive species. So Sarah, I'm going to hand off presenter status to you.
How's that working, Erica?
We can see your title slide. Looks great.
Okay. Well, thanks, first of all, to Jim for providing some great background information on toxicology and field trials of Zequanox. I think that sets the stage nicely for me to move directly into a short presentation of a field trial of Zequanox in Lake Erie that occurred in November of 2014. So first of all, why did we take on a late season application of Zequanox in November? It's certainly not the optimal time to work in the Great Lakes and Lake Erie. But think back to August 2014 when Microcystis blooms near Toledo caused a do not drink order to be placed on the drinking water of 500,000 residents. Harmful algae blooms are a big concern, especially in Lake Erie, since they can create these taste and odor issues and potentially unsafe conditions for drinking water, in addition to affecting recreation and aesthetics. This is an image on the top there of Lake Erie last year. Multiple factors contribute to these harmful algae blooms, primarily nutrient inputs and internal loading, but zebra and quagga mussels' ability to selectively feed can create conditions that may support harmful algae blooms. The mussels are able to selectively reject food items while filter feeding, including toxin-producing microcystis, which can create those conditions that support the growth and proliferation of microcystis blooms. There's much we need to learn about zebra and quagga mussels, food web linkages, especially in the lower food web, where mussels' effect on nutrient cycling in the algal community can be complex. However, we need to remember and consider the role of invasive mussels in harmful algae blooms. At the same time last year, successful Zequanox treatments in Minnesota were publicized in Inland Lakes, as well as the announcement in June of last year from the United States Environmental Protection Agency approval for the registration of Zequanox for the control of zebra and quagga mussels for recreational and environmental restoration in open waters of lakes and reservoirs. Early testing in these calm open waters that Jim has described, as well as some more dynamic systems like Minnetonka, these trials occurred in inland lakes. And the evaluation of Zequanox to either the benthic layer or whole water column treatment, mostly focused on the use of a 5% Zequanox stock solution. The treatments have been shown to be successful in reducing muscle mortality as high as 99%. However, we wondered if this type of benthic layering of product could occur in a complex and challenging high wind and wave environment found in the Great Lakes. So all of these things coming together have set us up for the project that occurred last year. The project objectives were to evaluate the application methods for Zequanox use in the Great Lakes, so how can we deliver the product to Obempo, and also to determine the ability of a concentrated stock solution to Zequanox to maintain a benthic treatment for about 6 hours. The 6-hour target was determined to be a good contact time from other work on developing procedures for treating power plant intake that was conducted, I think, by Marone Bioinnovations and USGS. The third objective was to monitor turbidity, conductivity, dissolved oxygen, and pH during the treatment to identify any impact to water quality. I noticed that measuring product efficacy is not one of the objectives for this project. The purpose of the project was focused on application technique. Product efficacy and non-target effects were outside of the scope of this project, but was covered by work done by Marone Bioinnovations, USGS, Minnesota, and Illinois DNR, and others. Besides, we would likely expect suboptimal muscle mortality during this time period due to a reduced filter feeding rate based on the cold water temperatures in Lake Erie in November, which in turn would result in reduced ingestion of Zequanox. So the project team, you can see on the bow of the boat, I'm not sure if that's Megan Weber. She was the project lead from Marone Bioinnovations. In the water, you can see Jason Brookstra from PLM, Lake and Land Management Corporation. USGS was on site. Jim was there with one of his colleagues. They traveled to Lake Erie to help with the treatment the day before and during treatment day. The application site was located in the western basin of Lake Erie, just south of Monroe and north of Luna Pier. The site did contain zebra mussels, mostly on cobble and other hard substrates, but the main substrate was unconsolidated sand. There's lots of wave action in this area, so unstable sand doesn't support prolific beds of zebra and quagga mussels. We moved the site a little bit closer to shore for crew safety since the water was very cold, and we wanted the crew to be able to touch bottom to set the turbidity curtains. We were working about 80 meters offshore in about 1.4 meters of water. The control location was designated with a buoy approximately 35 meters outside of the treatment area. Here's a schematic of the turbidity curtain that was used to create the enclosure for the treatment. The day prior to treatment, the team installed the barriers around the treatment area, adjusting the shape and depth of the treatment area to about 27 meters by 27 meters. We were in about 2-meter depth due to high wind and resulting rough wave action. The turbidity screen was provided by Marone Bioinnovations. As you can see, there's floating baffles on top. The turbidity screens were secured to the benthos with sandbags and cinder blocks. We worked out of Trout Yacht Basin in Monroe, Michigan, and that served as our mixing and staging area for the project. So in short, Marone Bioinnovation staff pumped the raw water from the harbor and mixed it with powdered Zequanox that occurred on shore. The mixed solution was then transferred to the application boat. Initially, Marone Bioinnovations tried for a 20% weight per volume stock solution, but the resulting solution was very thick and difficult to transfer, so we ended up with about 15% stock solution, which was transferred with the pump onto the application boat. The application boat then traveled to the treatment site and entered the enclosure and anchored in the center of the enclosure. PLM Lake and Land Management staff deployed a drop hose system with 4 injection points from the boat to the edge of the barriers. The drop hoses were adjusted to deliver the product to the bottom of the water column, and the product was continuously pumped through the drop hose system while circulating around the treatment area. Application of the product took about 20 minutes, which was equal to about 3 passes of the hose system over the area. you can see here in this image, drop hoses are located at each of the orange. Those are actually life coats marking where the drop hoses are. As you'll notice in this picture, the weather really cooperated on the treatment day. We couldn't have hoped for calmer waters in November. We had maybe 1 to 2 boat waves. Zequanox concentration has a linear relationship with turbidity, and so turbidity measurements are used to determine and calculate the concentration of Zequanox in the treated water. So here in this figure, we have time on the x-axis and calculated Zequanox concentration in milligrams of active ingredient per liter of water on the y. On treatment day, again, we had 10 to 15 mile hour winds. The waves were 1 to 2 feet in height. During the application, the layer of Zequanox could be seen visually in the treatment area, as indicated by cloudiness in the water at depth in the lower portion of the water column. From the figure, you can see we had good layering for about 3 hours. Water quality monitoring was established at 4 midpoints along the edges of the treatment area. One additional station, again, was an untreated control site. Temperature, pH, turbidity, and conductivity, dissolved oxygen measurements were taken from the bottom, middle, and surface at each station. Readings were taken prior to treatment, immediately after application, and every 30 minutes for the first 2 hours after application, and then approximately every hour thereafter until dark. And then once again, measurements were taken the following day. Temperature, DO, conductivity, and pH were similar between the treatment sites and similar between depths, also similar to the control site during the monitoring period. Results were within the expected ranges for this time of year in Lake Erie, so we didn't see a big DO sag or changes in pH or conductivity. There were slight differences in conductivity recorded between the treatment and control site, both prior to and during the Zequanox treatment, but this was likely due to the placement of the barrier on the treatment site. So lessons learned. The application of a concentrated stock solution to the bottom, working in a dynamic system like Lake Erie, was successful. We were able to set up stratification. We were able to deploy the barriers and do all the setup work that was necessary to work in this type of environment. We did see mixing of the water column by about 3 hours after application, so we didn't hit that 6-hour target. I think we need to learn more about, as Jim mentioned, what our targets need to be and how we measure that success. And the treatment had no lasting impact to water quality. I do just want to go back and mention, I know there's some interest in the review process and the permits needed to do this type of work in Michigan. The product is registered by the Michigan Department of Agriculture and Rural Development. As part of a product application, we required a National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, an NPDES pesticide permit for aquatic animal treatment. This involved a preliminary toxicology review. I say preliminary because at that time we anticipated forthcoming toxicology information to be published in 2015 by USGS. So this toxicology review is a little bit outdated already based on the new development in our understanding of non-target impact. As part of the NPDES permit, we had a 30-day public notice period. In addition to the public notice period, there was a targeted outreach effort to landowners in the vicinity of the treatment area, although that was not required for this treatment on Great Lakes bottomlands. For temporary placement of turbidity curtains working on Great Lakes bottomlands and for navigational purposes, we obtained a Part 325 Great Lakes Submerged Lands General Permit, a joint U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and MDEQ permit, and then we also notified Michigan DNR law enforcement. So with that, I would like to thank all of the partners who participated in this project and contributed to slides. Many of these slides were from Megan Weber from Rome Bioinnovation and information for this presentation. I'd like to thank Marone Bioinnovations for taking the lead on this project, Jim and Todd from the USGS Upper Midwest Environmental Science Center. They provided their time and assistance, including the use of a barge for barrier installation and treatment execution, PLM Lake Management for their work to implement the application system for this project. And I don't have it listed here, but I should acknowledge Tom Trout and Trout's Yacht Basin providing the staging area, and they actually provide a forklift for us to move around equipment, and many others who supported this project prior to treatment day. With that, Erica, let me know if you have any questions.
Thanks, Sarah. I do believe we have a couple questions submitted, and we have some time for those right now, so we'll go ahead and take them.
Okay, our first question is, how toxic is Zequanox to humans, and is the use of a respiratory or respirator during application precautionary?
I have not been involved in the toxicology testing. I know they did use a respirator during mixing, and I believe just face masks during the application as a precautionary measure, but perhaps Jim or Megan could speak to the toxicology.
Jim, do you have any insight you can provide on that?
So what was the first question about the toxicology part? I'm sorry, I missed it.
It was how toxic is Zequanox to humans, and is the use of a respiratory or respirator during application precautionary?
I think the label states that you need to basically wear a dust mask. I'd have to refer to the label to be absolutely sure on that, but I think that's what's required. It is the active ingredient in Zequanox is classified as tolerant, it's exempt. Meaning that there's no tolerance for foodstuffs for humans. So like the mammalian toxicity is extremely low.
And we can probably follow up with the person who asked this question and provide them some additional information and put them in contact with Marone for more information on that. All right, and we have one more question for Sarah, I believe.
Our next question is about water quality parameters and if any samples were taken for microbiological analysis.
As part of this application, no, we did not do additional water quality parameters since the focus of the study was simply on application methodology. So that's certainly a future direction, an area where we could learn more.
Thank you. I believe that's all the questions we have right now. So we will move on to our final presenters of the morning, Keegan Lund and Kylie Bloodsworth. Keegan and Kylie are invasive species specialists with the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources. Their work focuses on the prevention and management of aquatic invasive species throughout the metro area of Minneapolis and St. Paul. And they are going to discuss some work done in Minnesota using Zequanox. So, Keegan, I'm going to hand off presenter status to you here.
Okay, Eric, does everything look okay?
Yes, we can see your title slide and we can hear you.
Great. So Jim and Sarah's presentation have kind of paved the way appropriately for our presentation. Kyle and I will be talking about an in-lake trial using Zequanox as part of a rapid response control effort on Christmas Lake in Minnesota. Let's move on. We're frozen, so one moment. There. Okay. So Christmas Lake is a lake outside of the metro area in the Minneapolis-St. Paul area. and we'll be talking about the infestation today and the DNR and others' rapid response efforts to, in hopes to eradicate the isolated population of zebra mussels in that lake. We'll go through the monitoring efforts that that took place, our kind of initial rapid response timeline, and discuss kind of stakeholder coordination and others were that were involved with this project. Also, we'll talk about zebra mussel distribution and the copious amounts of lake-wide surveys that took place in order to, with confidence, say that the population was indeed isolated to a small location. We'll go through the actual Zequanox treatment, which may be a bit repetitive after Sarah's information, and then also talk about some of the, I guess, follow-up efforts that took place after Zequanox, briefly touching on a couple of other products that were used based off more zebra mussels that were found after our copious amounts of searching. So just to provide some reference, Minneapolis-St. Paul are in the background map. Again, the main metropolitan area in Minnesota. Christmas Lake is just to the west of there in the yellow box and below a lake called Lake Minnetonka, which is the largest lake in the Twin Cities that was infested with zebra mussels in 2010 and has a high amount of recreational use throughout the year. And, you know, likely would be the source of the zebra mussel infestation in Christmas Lake. Christmas Lake itself is around 250 acres with a max depth of 87 feet and one public access in the northwest corner. And zebra mussels were first discovered in August of 2014 by the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District. So, the, you know, one thing to point out, I think, with this presentation is these rapid response efforts would not have taken place with all the without all the partners that were involved. Specifically, the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District has a very active aquatic invasive species early detection monitoring program. They have two full-time staff and one intern, and they survey basically the majority of their lakes every summer, at least once or twice, doing baseline lake-wide surveys, veliger tows, and really a lot of in-lake snorkeling. And they're not just looking for zebra mussels, they're looking for all aquatic invasives. So again, as said before, the zebra mussels were first found August of 2014, actually August 16th, by the watershed district. They were first found on a settlement sampler, which was attached to the public access dock. August 18th, the DNR confirmed the infestation and performed some initial surveys with the watershed district. Those initial surveys indicated that at the time, the population of zebra mussels was isolated too near the public access. 2 days later, we convened a meeting with stakeholders in the watershed district to discuss kind of rapid response and potential control efforts. And the next day, a containment barrier was installed by the Watershed District and the DNR. And it was a similar kind of vinyl float curtain that was displayed in Sarah's presentation. And from August 18th through September 5th, there was a number of lake-wide population assessments, and those included, so veliger tows, snorkel surveys, weighting of the shoreline, and we basically did assess the entire shoreline of the lake out to a depth of probably 6 to 8 feet. And then on September 8th was the actual Zequanox treatment. So again, talking about some of the partners, from a management perspective, moving so quickly with our efforts really could not have happened without the involvement of all of these groups. The Minnehaha Creek Watershed District in many ways co-led or led this project and really, I guess, took charge along with the DNR in terms of moving things forward. Also, the University of Minnesota, Dr. Mike McCartney assisted greatly with population assessments and also just guidance on monitoring and potential control efforts. And then we had a number of other groups, consultants, Blue Water Science, the Christmas Lake Homeowners Association was very supportive of the efforts, and the City of Shore, which is the nearest municipality. So we found these zebra mussels, and you know, in order to try to respond to them, control them, or eradicate them, we really needed to isolate the population. And so the map on the left, I apologize that it is small, shows a number of sample points. That doesn't necessarily mean we surveyed just at those colored points, but that was locations taken. Also, the blue dots in the middle are locations of villager toads. Basically, what these efforts entail is that we put over 100 hours trying to isolate the zebra mussel population and also assess, is that population reproductive? And upon all our surveys, there were no sources of villagers found at any time, and the zebra mussels were indeed isolated to the public access, which is that red diamond in the upper left corner of the map. That's good. Do you want me to keep going, or you want to take?
You can take over.
Okay. With that, Kylie's going to take over from here.
Alrighty, so now we're going to talk a little bit about the Zequanox treatment itself, the application, and then also what types of product efficacy testing we did and those results from that testing. So I'm actually glad that I left this, where we left the slide in, because this kind of just gives you a general background of the product itself. So, of course, manufactured by Marone Bioinnovations, which we've mentioned, it's a molluscicide. So not a pesticide, but in fact made out of dead bacterial cells. it's attractive because it's a very highly selective product. So it selects specifically for zebra mussels and quagga mussels, and then, as we've talked about before, has very little impact on non-target species, if any. And up until this point, where we were, you know, playing around and trying to figure out what products we wanted to use, the only examples of application that were available to us came from the state of Illinois through Marone Bio. They did some efficacy trials using this product, as well as USGS in some northwest lakes in Minnesota. So in terms of the treatment itself, this took place in early September, and the number of mussels that we actually found at the public boat launch were approximately 5,500 juveniles. So that's kind of what we had to work with. The treatment was completed by PLM as well as Marone Bioinnovations. And we used a floating, that yellow curtain barrier you can see in the photo right there. We used that to quarantine the infestation as well as to maintain the concentration for the treatment itself. So that was about a 50 by 60 foot area, 3,000 square feet. And here this gives you some insight on the product cost as well as the barrier material itself. So as Keegan mentioned, we wanted to develop some sort of monitoring protocol. This really was sort of the first real life application of using this product in a real life situation. So we wanted to make sure that we documented as well, in addition to adding on to the knowledge that we already had about product efficacy. So in collaboration with the University of Minnesota, we developed a pre- and post-treatment monitoring protocol. And this outlined looking at the concentration of the products within the lake, as well as recording the number of zebra mussels that died, so zebra mussel mortality. And we did so in two fashions. We wanted to look at zebra mussel mortality in the lake itself, so actually at the treatment site. And so this is a photo provided by Marone, where you have these colored cubes made out of plastic mesh. And so it's just a way to monitor zebra mussels and keep them all in one concentrated area as you're doing this type of experiment. And then this, of course, can be replicated in the laboratory. And so that's what these other two photos in the center and the right show. You have these acrylic tubes where you can place a certain number of zebra mussels in and some mesh around to contain them and conduct trials in that fashion. So now I'll present some results from the efficacy trials that we actually did. These graphs were created by the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District, and then they were also the ones that performed all the experiments for this portion of the project. So here you have data from the in-lake cage trial, so those brightly colored cubes. We used that method and placed about 100 mussels to start with. And then each day, we verified the number of live, crushed, ones that were gaping, and then, of course, recorded the number that were dead. And so you can see that cumulatively, that number increased over time, and that we had about 100% mortality by day 10. The Watershed District also took the time to measure dissolved oxygen concentrations at the surface and at depths, and so you can see here that the dissolved oxygen concentrations dropped significantly within the first 24 hours of the treatment. Another thing the Watershed District did was they wanted to kind of get an overall assessment of those 5,500 juvenile mussels that we were controlling. And so they selected four different locations near and around the dock and landing in both shallow and at 1.5 feet depth. They counted about 50 at each of their four sites after the treatment and documented the number of dead versus alive. So it's just taking a sub-sample of the actual population within the treatment area. And here the blue line, you can see that similar to the caged results, they found mortality at about 100% by day 11. And in addition to that, they saw similar results with the dissolved oxygen. So finally, for the aquaria testing, they set up three control tanks and then three treatment tanks, used those acrylic tubes. They placed about 50 mussels within each of those tubes and dosed those treatment tanks accordingly. Here we see that 100% mortality was achieved by starting day 7 for some of the tanks and by day 10 for all three of those tanks. Again, they measured dissolved oxygen and there was no mortality found in the control tanks. So just to kind of summarize the use of the product of Zequanox, we've seen through applications outside of Minnesota and with other organizations, as well as our observations, that this product is extremely effective. In our trials, both in the laboratory as well as out in the field, we saw 100% mortality achieved around day 10. And then in addition, this product is highly selective towards zebra mussels. We saw no negative impacts to non-target organisms within the treatment area. Another strength of this product is it has no regulatory restrictions. And then finally, one final consideration is that this product may be potentially cost prohibitive for larger treatment areas, so might be more suited for smaller treatments such as the one we did here. So in addition to the treatment, the Zequanox treatment, we have also done several other treatments on Christmas Lake to date, and I won't go into any detail about them, but would be happy to take any questions if there are specific questions. But using other control methods, specifically pesticides, EarthTech QZ is one of them. It's a copper-based product, and then also Myriad of Potash, which is potassium chloride. And similar to Zequanox, both of these products are extremely effective as well as selective towards zebra mussels as well as quagga mussels. So with these efforts, we did similar monitoring protocols. We looked at concentrations within the lake and then also measured efficacy in cage trials as well as in laboratory trials. During the application itself, we also used a treatment barrier to contain the infestation as well as to maintain concentrations of these products. So here you have kind of a snapshot in time of the different treatments or the different control efforts that have taken place on Christmas Lake from 2014 to date. And so here you have the small black box that shows where the Zequanox treatment took place near the public boat launch, that 3,000 square foot area. And you'll notice that the other treatments were expanded. So you have in blue the EarthTech treatment as well as the potash treatment that was performed there in the late fall and into December. And then upon post-treatment assessment in the spring, we have also expanded our treatment area beyond the public boat launch. So the green and the red outlining some of the most recent treatments we've done using the product potash this summer. So in summary, Keegan, you know, emphasized a lot of these as a very important and sort of essential pieces for doing such a type of control and rapid response efforts. So the early detection monitoring performed by the watershed district was crucial. The extensive as well as early population assessment to really target, you know, what we have here. Are zebra mussels widespread? Are they reproducing in the lake? And then what types of control efforts do we have in our pocket to use? One sort of head scratcher that we're still trying to figure out is how big you actually go with the treatment area. If you recall the previous slide that I showed you with those different treatments that we did, we continued to do treatments because there were always zebra mussels found outside the treatment that we did. So we continued to extend or expand our area. So that's something that we still need to try and tease out. Other important sort of learning experiences we had were it's sometimes difficult to monitor both concentration as well as mortality in lake settings. So experiments are extremely easy to do in laboratory settings, but sometimes the cage trials don't always work out how you want them to do. So things like field measuring equipment to monitor the concentrations of the products were extremely important. The use of a curtain barrier to not only contain the infestation but also maintain those concentrations. And finally, the cage trials will show you sort of a real life example of what's happening in terms of mortality. Post-treatment, pre and post-treatment monitoring protocol was essential to have that standardized. And then finally, just the partnerships and good communication. So involving the right people and the right decision makers from the beginning and communicating often was essential for having a successful project. So with that, I don't know if we have any time to take some questions, but we're available to do so. And Keegan and my email are listed at the bottom of this slide right here. And so feel free to contact us directly if you have additional questions beyond this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Kylie and Keegan. We do have a number of questions that have been submitted. So both for Keegan and Kylie and our other panelists. So we're going to start working through those now.
Okay, we have quite a few questions, and some of them are related about DO, so we'll try to consolidate those. But our first question is, was in-lake treatment concentration maintained for 10 days, or does that represent die-off following label treatment?
So this is Keegan. So one important thing that I apologize for failing to put in the presentation, but, you know, for what the DNR and the Watershed District was trying to do, which was eradicate the mussels, it really would be impossible to tease out mortality between the products Zequanox and anoxia, or dissolved oxygen, low dissolved oxygen. You know, because the DNR chose to leave the barrier in, you know, there were anoxic conditions within the treatment barrier. And so hopefully that gets at that question.
Okay. Next question?
Sure. So did the water go anoxic with the application of Zequanox? And could this be a reason for high mortality?
Yeah, basically yes. You know, and like I said, we couldn't tease out between the two, between the Aquaria trials, which we took treated water from the treatment area and placed them into the Aquaria and in the treatment area itself. You know, because of the influx of all this biological material, which is Zequanox, we created these anoxic conditions. So again, looking at the information that we present doesn't get at the efficacy necessarily of the product, but more shows our rapid response efforts in terms of trying to eradicate zebra mussels. I think there'd be other information available in terms of looking at the efficacy of this product, and what we presented isn't that.
If I can interject here, it's Jim. We don't typically see a drop in DO, a significant drop in DO, until after 12 hours of application, and we do see significant mortality, albeit not 100% mortality, in 8 hours of exposure. The product label does only permit treating half of a water body at a time. You know, I'm not saying that you can treat half a Christmas lake, but and that would help eliminate some of the anoxic conditions for an open water application.
So we've had some follow-ups to those first two questions. I know we have other questions, but I'm going to ask those first since they're related. There was a question about whether Zequanox concentrations were maintained over 10 days, or was it just a one-time application?
Sure. So this is Keegan again. Marone Bio monitored concentrations immediately after treatment upon treatment, but post-treatment they were not monitored. So we have no idea what concentrations of Zequanox were maintained over that period of time.
Okay. We had another follow-up question, which was, if you did experience anoxia in the treatment area, weren't there adverse effects on non-target organisms in that treatment area?
It was such a small treatment area that none were observed, but again, we weren't actively monitoring on a daily basis for non-target effects, but none were observed.
And this, Jim, again, just a point of clarification. Zequanox is normally only applied in a single application. And also, after hydration, so after the dry product is wetted, the toxicity to drusenid mussels is only there for about 24 hours, and then it becomes non-toxic to drusenid mussels.
Okay, our next question is fairly similar on the same topic, but it does have a follow-up question. The question was, can you explain the DO response after treatment, and why does DO increase after 6 or 7 days?
I think that the DO response after treatment was explained due to the maintaining of the treatment barrier. In terms of response, let me just refer back to a graph. I would assume that the DO increase after, it looks like day 8 of the in-lake graph, would potentially be the result of either product settlement or product degradation. Maybe Jim could share more on that.
Yeah, I mean, the drop is because there's a lot of organic material that's being decomposed, and I would assume that it's just a natural process that it's going to come back after the decomposition is slowing down.
This is Kylie, and I know that they measured the dissolved oxygen at the surface as well as the depth, and I would have to look back at the data to see if that was an average of the two. So potentially, depending on what environmental factors there were, such as wind and mixing, that might have attributed to the increase depending on what days that those were at the end of this trial. So.
Okay, this question is, again, along that same question line. It might be quite similar, but the question is, do you think that the efficacy of the product was related to such low DO levels or the product itself?
Again, this is Keegan, and we couldn't parse out the difference between the two.
Okay, I think that is the majority of our DO questions. We had another question about effects on non-target organisms, which you went into a little bit, but do you have anything else to share on that?
I might point out that in our trials that we did in our in-lake enclosures and in our trailer trials, you know, we did thorough water quality monitoring, and we can attribute the mortality due to the product ingestion not to dissolved oxygen.
Okay, and our last DO question here. Mm-hmm. You've already fully answered, I think, the drop in DO, but this question is in regards to comparison with the Lake Erie trial and why there was an extreme drop in this field trial but not in the Lake Erie trial.
Yeah, I'm not sure how Sarah's group monitored for DO, if they were monitoring at different depths. You know, our treatment was a complete, or our, you know, within our treatment area was completely mixed upon treatment. We didn't have, you know, any sort of layering, and nor was that the target or scope of the treatment. And so upon the termination of the treatment, everything was fully mixed, and I would assume that would be attributed then. Or you could attribute the rapid decline of DO because of that active mixing.
Okay. Sarah, do you have anything on monitoring for DO for Lake Erie?
Sure. I can speak to the a little bit more detail. The way the Lake Erie pilot application was run was day one, we set up the barriers. Day two was treatment day. And day three, we did one more water quality monitoring and then removed the barrier. So the duration sounds like it was quite different. Another thing to consider is that we were working in Lake Erie, so there was a lot of wave action, and also it was November, so water temperatures were quite cold. DO was measured using standard sonde type probe at four locations within the enclosure. At the bottom, middle, and top of the water column, and we did not see those types of DO sags, likely due to wave action timing and temperature.
Thanks. Okay, we have a couple more monitoring questions. Did the AIS monitoring include DNA testing for dracaenid mussels?
At Christmas Lake, no.
Okay. We have another question about native mussels and if there were populations of native mussels in the lake, and if so, how were they dealt with, and do you have any suggestions for other rapid responses from your experience?
Sure. So there was one native mussel found within the Zequanox treatment area. That mussel survived. The other treatments that were performed following our Zequanox application was EarthTech and potassium chloride. Christmas Lake has three species of native mussels, and within those treatment areas, the potassium chloride or potash is of course lethal to all mussels, and those mussels, what we did was we tried to remove and relocate the majority of those mussels beforehand. There was some non-target related mortality to native mussels that were not removed and relocated. But those were our efforts. You know, we collected as many as we could and moved them in lake. Well, first we made sure that those mussels were indeed clean. We found, just as a side note, in the spring of this year, the majority, actually all of the zebra mussels that were found attached to native mussels. They were not found anywhere else on sticks or rocks, which was where we were finding them in the fall of 2014. And so every mussel that was relocated was, of course, kind of cleaned and scrubbed and then moved to a different part of the lake where there was suitable native mussel habitat. Did I get at the question?
The next question is about, I guess we have a suggestion, really. A suggestion for the DO conversation that was happening earlier, and the suggestion was that the evaluation of Zequanox toxicity could be teased out from low DO impacts by placing zebra mussel in cages for 24 hours, taking them out, and then placing in untreated water and comparing the mortality. Do you have any thoughts on that or ideas about if that would work?
I'll let Jim tackle that.
That's essentially what our mobile lab study did. We did two studies with our mobile lab, one in Lake Carlos, Minnesota, and the other in Shawano Lake in Wisconsin, where we had treated mussels in replicated tanks for 6, 9, and 12 hours of exposure at 1,500 milligrams per liter. They were then, after that exposure duration, placed in a cage and maintained in the lakes for 30 days and then assessed for survival after that time. So that's essentially what was done in that trial. And also in some of the in-lake enclosure trials, we did the same type of thing where we caged the animals and were able to determine a mortality rate because with the when we did density on rocks and also when we're going to do the biomass, when those animals die, they can slough off. So unless you actually contain them, you can't really get at mortality.
Okay, I think we have one last question for Keegan, and then we have a couple questions for everyone, and then some specific questions for Sarah and Jim. So we'll just ask Keegan his last question here. So this is another mortality question, Keegan, and you answered this a little bit, but can you go into detail more about which species were monitored and how mortality was assessed?
So in terms of species that were monitored for any of our, I guess, mortality assessments, it was only looking at zebra mussel related mortality. Again, this was a eradication, you know, rapid response effort. The products that were utilized, all I guess were registered at some level. The use of potash needed a emergency exemption to be used as a pesticide within the United States. And the non-target issue really was of secondary concern for us at the time.
Okay, thanks, Keegan. We have a couple questions here for the group, so feel free to answer if you feel like you have a great answer here. Our first question is, have there been any studies done with Zequanox and its effectiveness on quagga mussels in inland lakes?
Marone has done extensive work with comparison of zebra mussels and quaggas, and I don't believe that they have shown any difference in toxicity. It is, to the best of my knowledge, equally effective against quaggas and zebras.
Okay. And we can follow up with the person who asked that question and put them in contact with Marone and other information on that topic.
We have another question that might be a little harder to answer, but considering what has been found through all the studies presented today, what is the best control method for zebra or quagga infestation? And do these findings show that Zequanox does not show feasibility as a control for an infestation in a lake setting?
I would say prevention is the best control method. Zequanox, I think, you know, needs more evaluation. There's potential for formulations at all times. Types of different work. We're just in our infancy and descended mussel control, so it's too early probably to pass judgment on anything at this point.
Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
I would just like to add, I think it depends on your management objective and what you're trying to achieve.
No, I would exactly echo what Sarah and Jim said. The other thing that I would add is, you know, our trials or control efforts on Christmas Lake really, I guess, taught us that there's much more to be learned on all of the products that we utilize and potential different application methods, even the potential of some sort of combined treatments. I think there's a lot more information that needs to be researched and evaluated.
Okay, we have a follow-up question to that, and it's if there's been any work done on the effect of the product on endangered mussels.
We did, some of our work was done with the Higgins eye, which is a federally endangered mussel. There's also some state listed mussels. The washboard is one. I think some additional animals were done by other entities as well that are state or federal listed.
And again, we can follow up with the person who asked that question, and to the extent that we have access to the those resources and studies that we know of, we can direct that person to those.
Okay, Jim, while you're answering questions, we do have a question specific to your presentation. The question is about mortality rates and if you can offer a breakdown of morbidity for each species rather than simply mention the morbidity rates for one species.
I don't have the data in front of me, but if you can probably answer this, Eric, if the citations for our open file reports are on the website yet, all the muscle work that we have done, non-target work, is published in open file reports, and all that information is readily available on that.
Yes, Jim, we will make sure those studies and your data that you've referenced today are posted along with the webinar recording. So look for those in the next few days.
Okay, Sarah, we also have a few specific questions for you. The first is, did the treatment work?
Well, maybe this is going to be my standard option. It depends on what your management objectives are and how you define success. So if simply my opinion on did it work, our project objectives were to test application techniques. And in that respect, we were successful. We were able to deploy the equipment, achieve some benthic layering. We didn't hit that six-hour target. But we were able to work in Lake Erie to get a benthic layer.
Great. We have one more question specifically for you, which is, have any studies been done to measure the amount of natural pseudomonas which may be found in areas with high levels of turbidity, such as an inflow zone?
That isn't something that Michigan DEQ has been part of looking at. I don't know if Jim has any insight on that one. The work in Michigan was simply testing application techniques.
Okay, we had another question, another follow-up DO question from Keegan's presentation about the Carlos study, and it would be helpful to know more about the results of the Carlos study and how much mortality could be attributed to DO versus Zequanox over time.
Yeah, I think Jim would have to speak to that. Sorry, Jim.
I can answer that. We don't attribute any of the mortality in the Carlos study to drops in DO. And again, that information is published in an OFR that will be available, so you can look at all the water quality and all the mortality through the various treatments. But it definitely was not related to dissolved oxygen.
We do have just a couple more.
And we do have a couple more questions, and we have just a couple minutes left in the webinar, so we're going to take those also.
Okay, so if interested, how should academics get involved and apply for funding for research about these needed knowledge gaps?
Could you repeat that question?
Sure. If interested, how would you suggest academics get involved or apply for funding for research about these needed knowledge gaps?
I couldn't answer that, sorry.
I think this is something that Muscle Collaborative is going to be looking at as we identify these research needs and gaps, and first identifying those gaps and then looking for opportunities to get that work funded and addressed. So this is something that Collaborative is thinking about, and would encourage folks participating today, if you have thoughts on that, to share them. But this is something that Collaborative will be working on.
Okay, and our last question is, what is the cost of treatment with Zequanox? I know a couple of you presented information on that, so if it was in your presentation, you might not need to repeat it, but if you can just give us an estimate, that would be great.
Sure, so this is Keegan. So our treatment area, which was roughly 3,000 square feet. The product and labor cost was $6,800.
Sarah, do you have information on costs for your effort that you can share?
No, I don't really have a tally for the cost of just the treatment day, and I don't even have on hand exactly how much the product costs, so I'm not sure on that.
Jim, did you do any sort of cost analysis as part of your test?
We really don't. Marone typically provided that information for a product as a partner. I will say that, you know, our work and research is more expensive than if you're conducting necessarily a whole lake or bay or something like that type of treatment, where we're doing replicated studies and a lot of labor going into the monitoring and whatnot. So, you know, if it was scaled up, I'm sure the cost would eventually come down. It's a supply and demand thing, but that's probably best answered by folks from Marone Bioinnovations at this time.
All right. Well, I think we have reached the end of our questions, and I thank you all for your patience and interest as we work through all the questions we received today. I also want to thank our presenters for taking the time to provide that information and answer these challenging questions today. As a reminder, we have recorded this webinar, and it will be posted on the Invasive Mussel Collaborative website. In the next few days, we will also be linking to those studies that Jim has mentioned. And as a reminder, our website is www.invasivemusclecollaborative.net. I would encourage you, if you have any additional follow-up questions or comments, to contact us at the Great Lakes Commission or any of our speakers today. If you have ideas for future webinar topics, you are also welcome to submit them to us at the Great Lakes Commission, and we will bring those to the collaborative for consideration. And once again, thank you to all of our participants and presenters today, and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you all.